After a nebulous half-decade for the globally beloved animation studio, Studio Ghibli seems once again to be back on the front pages of every entertainment column worldwide. Ghibli, the creative force behind innumerable legendary anime films, of which Spirited Away, Princess Mononoke, Howl's Moving Castle, Grave of the Fireflies, and My Neighbor Totoro only scratched the surface, spent most of the 80s, 90s, and 2000s turning out classic after classic on a near annual basis. Alas, that incredible production run ended in 2014 with When Marnie Was There, directed by Yonebayashi Hiromasa, and the subsequent announcement of the liquidation of the company's production department. A Ghibli drought of 6 long years followed. Thankfully, not all has been gloom and doom for fans of the vaunted studio. 2017 saw Ghibli co-founder and worldwide icon Miyazaki Hayao come out of retirement with the announcement of his new film, How Do You Live?, or Kimitachi wa Dou Ikiru ka?, whose release date is still not announced. The past few months have also brought in a wave of Ghibli coverage thanks to the studio's library, long available only through physical media, finally being made available on streaming throughout much of the world, on Netflix in most places besides Japan, and on HBO Now in North America. And this very week, the final piece of this Ghibli revival has fallen into place. Ohayou mina! Welcome to Unseen Japan, your one-stop spot for in-depth news, essays, and videos on Japanese history, culture, and current events. I'm Noah Oskow, a UJ staff writer and longtime Japanese translator. I usually focus on long-form coverage of Japanese historical events, but as a lifelong fan of Studio Ghibli, seeing Princess Mononoke as a kid literally set me down the lifelong path that's brought me to an academic and professional career focused on Japan, I'm happy to take a little time out to discuss an announcement I've long been waiting for. I have another, much more extensive video on Studio Ghibli coming out soon, so if you like what you hear, give us a like and subscribe. Anyway, back to the good news. Ghibli itself is primarily the brainchild of three men, directors Miyazaki Hayao and the late Takahata Isao, alongside producer Suzuki Toshio. The majority of the studio's output and the majority of its most beloved films were helmed by the two aforementioned creators. However, 7 of its 22 or so films are the products of other directors. Many of these movies resulted from an attempt to discover directorial talent that could carry on the Ghibli legacy after Miyazaki and Takahata eventually stopped producing films. The period between 2002's The Cat Returns, directed by Morita Hiroyuki, represented a major uptick in films from such directors, with over half of Ghibli's movies from that period being made by someone other than the old masters. Among all these new faces in the director's chair, only 2 would reprise that role for Ghibli. One was Yonebayashi Hiromasa, a longtime Ghibli animator who helmed 2010's successful Arrietty, or Karigarashi no Arrietty, and the aforementioned Marnie. Yonebayashi actually led an exodus of Ghibli talent away from the studio in 2015 following the liquidation of the production team, founding a quasi-successor studio called Studio Ponoc. The other director was Miyazaki Goro. The last name is no coincidence. Goro is indeed the son of Ghibli's own legendary Hayao. The fact that Goro ever came to helm a film involved a great deal of conflict within the studio. His father famously balked at the idea of Goro, a talented artist but not an animator, suddenly being thrust into the director's chair. Producer Suzuki Toshio, however, saw a raw talent in Goro that belied his lack of experience. Father and son were not on speaking terms for the entirety of the production of the film that followed. Goro's own Tales from Earthsea, released in 2006, became Ghibli's only critical dud. Despite box office success and even his father's grudging approval, Earthsea became a source of mass derision for Goro. The young director was even awarded the Japanese equivalent of a Razzie for worst film that year. However, despite the abuse, Goro still returned to animation in 2011 with From Up on Poppy Hill, co-written by his father. This movie was widely praised and helped to repair Goro's reputation. Poppy Hill's positive reception and strong box office inclined many to believe that Goro would soon be back with another film. Surprisingly, 9 years passed without this coming to be. Rather, Goro's one additional foray into animation was as director of a 2014 CG anime TV series based on Astrid Lindgren's Ronya the Robber's Daughter. The show itself was a co-production between Ghibli and Polygon Pictures. This show also received positive reviews, including for its CG animation, yet still 6 more years passed from Ronya's release without any formal announcement of a new project for Goro. Finally, Suzuki Toshio began hinting that a new CG animated film was in the works. Only a few weeks prior to this video, Suzuki revealed that Goro had indeed been assigned to helm said CG film. And now, at long last, we have the official announcement of Ghibli and Goro's newest film, Earwig and the Witch, or in Japanese, Aya Tomacho. Goro's new film will be a CG animated movie for television to be based on a novel by beloved British author Deanna Wynne Jones. Famously, Miyazaki Sr. adapted Jones's Howl's Moving Castle into what became one of his most successful and enduring films. Jones crafted a huge catalog of cherished children's novels during her long career. Earwig and the Witch itself was finished only shortly before Jones tragically passed on in 2011, and was released posthumously. HarperCollins, who published the book, summarized its story as so. Not every orphan would love living at St. Morwald's Home for Children, but Earwig does. She gets whatever she wants whenever she wants it, and it's been that way since she dropped on the orphanage's doorstep as a baby. But all that changes the day Bella Yaga and the Mandrake come to St. Morwald's, disguised as foster parents. Earwig is whisked off to their mysterious house full of invisible rooms, potions, and spellbooks, with magic around every corner. Most children would run in terror from a house like that, but not Earwig. Using her own cleverness, with a lot of help from a talking cat, she decides to show the witch who's boss. Meanwhile, NHK, where Goro's film will be airing, has added this small description. One day, Aya, a young girl raised so as to be unaware that she is a witch's daughter, is brought to a strange house. The story begins as she's made to live there with an ill-tempered witch. Worthy of note is that Goro's father, Hayao, assisted with Aya's planning and is producing and supervising the film. This marks the second collaboration between Miyazaki's junior and senior following Poppy Hill. So, since I really like thinking about these sorts of things, I'd like to take a moment to just talk about a few things we can kind of think on regarding the announcement of this new film by Miyazaki Goro. There's a number of aspects that make the announcement of Aya Tomacho, or Earwig and the Witch, so interesting. For one, there's the implication that this movie must be fairly close to being completed, despite only just having been announced. The movie is actually already listed on the official selection for the 2020 Festival du Cannes, although said festival will not be physically taking place as a result of the ongoing COVID-19 crisis. Additionally, the movie is scheduled for release on Japanese television network NHK sometime this winter. In other words, we're only half a year away from seeing Ghibli's newest work. And the fact that this is a television release is also highly interesting if you're a fan of Studio Ghibli. Ghibli has only ever done one other movie for TV. That was Ocean Waves, or Umi ga Kikoeru, which was released almost 3 decades ago in 1993. That film, meant to be produced quickly, cheaply, and with quality, in Suzuki Toshio's words, famously went over budget and schedule, as any look at the beautiful animation can sort of point out to you. Perhaps this is what led to the lack of TV films by Ghibli thereafter. This may be the reasoning behind making this TV film using CG animation, which hopefully has helped keep down costs and has kept things on schedule. And indeed, Aya represents the first ever CG animated film for Studio Ghibli, a studio renowned for its devotion to high-quality hand-drawn animation. The studio has engaged in digital drawing and painting in the past, with notable examples being Takahata's My Neighbors the Yamadas and The Tale of the Princess Kaguya, but has always maintained a 2D appearance. The only exception was Miyazaki Sr.'s recent short film for the Ghibli Museum called Boro the Caterpillar, or Kemushi no Boro. That short represented a chance for Miyazaki to experiment with new animation technologies, although he's returned to traditional animation for How Do You Live. The decision to eschew 2D animation may sit uneasily with some, although Goro's experience on Ronya does make him the ideal Ghibli director for this task. Personally, I've never really gotten on board with this sort of 2D CG animation look. Especially in the past, a lot of the animation that came out with this style just looked choppy and just not very professionally done. However, finally watching some of Goro's Ronya the Robber's Daughter, I will say that his directorial talent when it comes to the use of this sort of CG animation is really pretty impressive, and especially for a TV show, he was able to make so many shots look almost like something out of a film, just dramatic with great framing and great depth of field. So I will say that if somebody's gonna do it, it should be him. Additionally, having watched the really popular show Beastars on Netflix, I've finally seen a show that manages to take that sort of animation style and make it look actually really, really good. So hopefully we'll see something a little bit like that, only perhaps on an even higher level of quality, considering that this is a full-on film, albeit a TV animation. Worthy of consideration as well is the film's length. also recently announced via Cannes. At 82 minutes, Hayato Majo will be somewhat short by Ghibli standards. Most Ghibli films range between 90 and 120 minutes, and only one of their films has been shorter than Aya looks to be, that being The Cat Returns, which at 75 minutes was pretty short for a theatrically released film. However, some of Ghibli's best films are surprisingly short. Grave of the Fireflies, for example, is 88 minutes long, which honestly is a little surprising to me. As anyone who's seen that movie knows, it's a pretty intense experience, and it's surprising that 88 minutes is all it took to get that across. Totoro, on the other hand, is even shorter at 86 minutes. So hopefully the slim running time won't be a detriment to Aya's story either. And the fact that the original novel itself is a brief 124 pages should make this more doable. Lastly, while we don't know much about the plot of the film in terms of how it will actually play out in the movie itself, since Ghibli adaptations tend to differ greatly from the source material, I mean, look at the other Deanna Wynne Jones adaptation, Howl's Moving Castle, it does share some noticeable commonalities with related movies. This will be the second Ghibli film with Witch in its Japanese title, since Kiki's Delivery Service was originally titled Majo no Takubin, or Witch's Delivery Service in Japanese. The story as seen in the book synopsis also bears some small similarities to Studio Ponoc's Mary and the Witch's Flower, a film which itself has often been accused, including by myself, of being overly derivative of previous Ghibli movies. Of course, Miyazaki Sr. made three separate movies with Castle in the title. That's Lupin the Third, Castle of Cagliostro, Castle in the Sky, and Howl's Moving Castle. And also, in the early 1980s, Miyazaki even sought to make a film to be entitled Warring States Demon Castle, or Sengoku Majo, although the idea was rejected. Anyway, if Miyazaki can make so many movies about castles, hopefully Aya can find its own identity as well, despite being another movie about a witch with a talking cat, just like Kiki and Mary in The Witch's Flower. Suzuki Toshio, who's often tasked with presenting and describing Ghibli creations and going-ons to the general public, had the following to say about Aya. What will our world be like after Corona? At current, this is the most important matter of concern for many people. This is unavoidable for film and television as well. Is Aya as a work something that can withstand the aftermath of Corona? I considered this many times as I looked over the film rushes. It's then that I realized that the defining aspect of this work is Aya's cleverness. With cleverness, you can make your way through any era. When I thought this, I felt a sense of relief. If Pippi Longstocking is the world's strongest girl, then Aya is a tale of the world's cleverest girl. Aya is herself a bit odious and yet somehow cute. I hope many people will come to love her. By the way, when I was thinking of who Aya might remind me of, it was in fact Goro-kun, the very director of this movie. When I pointed this out, Goro became bashful, as if embarrassed. With Aya suddenly right around the corner, 36 minutes of Goro's father's own How Do You Live completed, and Ghibli films streaming around the world, it is indeed a good time to be a fan of the legendary Studio Ghibli. The Ghibli revival is happening, and in the case of Hayato Majo, it will in fact be televised. Alright everybody, thanks for watching this relatively short video. Most of the videos I work on for UJ are way longer, but I thought it'd be fun to get something out there about what we know about this movie so far. Like I said, I have a much more in-depth video about the studio's films coming out soon, so keep an eye out for that. If you want to, the subscription button below should prove useful. And if you want an in-depth look at every Ghibli theatrical film, short, music video, direct-to-DVD feature, pre-Ghibli film, and spin-off, check out my The Ultimate Ranking of the Studio Ghibli Universe article series over at our main website. The link is in the description below. So, until next time, mata ne.